Good morning. This is Dr. Jean with Bride Time Live here in Houston, Texas. Yay! Please give it up for Minister Teo Fasan. Yay! Of Light Up America. He is from Nigeria, and we are going to hear about his life. What has God called him to do in the United States of America? And to hear his very unique position about the United States and what God is saying to the United States today. So, sir, if you don't mind telling us a little bit about your ministry, Light Up America.
Okay, this is the fourth edition. Light Up America was born in the course of waiting on the Lord about 7 years ago when we were in London.
I love London.
Yeah, yes. The Lord said, turn to America. And in the course of time, we realized the Lord wanted to beam a light that America needed to come into, that the church in America needed to come into.
Oh, wow.
So, Light Up America, this is the fourth edition.
Okay, let me stop you there. I want to make sure I'm understanding right. You was in London.
Yes.
And the Lord said, I want the light in America to shine brighter. So then God brought you to America.
Yes, please.
Wow, okay.
Okay, so basically, the ministry, I'm a pastor with, which is Eternal Glorious Fronting Ministries, is an itinerary ministry. So we have teaching conferences in different countries, but when the fullness of time came, the Lord was saying we should start a walk in America. And why the word light? Why Light Up America?
Yes.
America has witnessed a measure of light. A measure of light we can see in the book of Hebrews. It says, leaving therefore the elementary principles of the doctrines of Christ, let us go on to perfection. So there's a light that the church corporately in America has opened her doors to. But a time comes that we need to leave that light, meaning go beyond that light to the light that will perfect. So just like in physics and in chemistry, you have introduction to physics, introduction to chemistry, but that is not chemistry. So there is an elementary aspect of the gospel, but that is not the gospel. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes.
Right.
So what the power of God does is to cause a man to live with the very light God lives with. So we saw all through the Old Testament.
Now say that again. I want to make sure I understood.
Okay, what I said was that we saw what God desires is
okay.
what he brought to pass in the person of his son, Jesus, for the first time. For the first time, Jesus lived with the light that was in God. And he lived with that light until that light became his. And the Bible now says he was the true light. So we saw different men all through the Old Testament. Even John the Baptist, he was called a burning and a shining light. But that was a kind of light. That was not the light that God used. So the light that God uses is what he has now asked man to use so that God's civilization, God has a civilization.
Yeah.
The civilization that was packaged in the tree of life. The knowledge of God, which is the knowledge of his glory, was what was warehoused in the tree of life. And it's that knowledge, which is a light, which is God's personal light, that is the light he wants the church to live by, because that's the light that shines in darkness, and darkness does not comprehend it. So, all through the Old Testament, you find different believers who used different kinds of light, but that light could not overcome the darkness on earth. But finally, through our Lord Jesus and the early church, and what we saw in the apostles, God was able to introduce his light back to man through the tree that our Lord Jesus represented. And through that light, that light is meant to filter into the earth and become a civilization. In other words, man is meant to live by that light until he becomes a light.
Hmm. Well, all I can think of while you're talking about this light is this dream the Lord gave me about the tree, about forgiveness. Yeah. But the light, the sun was shining on the tree, and then that made it grow such beautiful fruit. Like, If you have the right light, it would produce much fruit on that tree, right?
Yes, please.
So if we're connecting to the rivers of living water and we're connecting to the tree of life, you know, really on earth, if you think about it, there's two different trees we connect to. The tree of knowledge of good and evil, which is the worldly system.
Yes, please.
And the tree of life, which is kingdom of heaven.
Very true.
So what you're saying is you're trying to connect America. You're trying to help America to connect to the tree, basically to make sure they're receiving the right light.
Yes.
Am I understanding you right?
Perfectly. But let me just paraphrase that.
Yes, please.
It's called the tree of the knowledge of life, which is a tree that houses a peculiar kind of life. Mind you, Adam did not partake of that life ultimately. He partook of something inferior. And the earth was under that life for some 4,000 years before our Lord Jesus came. So the light that is in the tree of life was actually what the Lord God was commanding Adam to live by. In other words, that light is a commandment. That light, like I said earlier, is meant to raise a new civilization. It's meant to raise kings. It says in the book of Matthew chapter 5, it says, the meek will inherit the earth, or the meek will possess the earth. Why? Because the light in God can raise a man to have the meekness of God. Moses was described as the meekest man upon the face of the earth. But that was when he was using a kind of light, not God's personal light. But God, through our Lord Jesus, has been able to introduce the light of life. And by that life, a man can become meek, meaning a man can have God's nature. Mm. You know, meaning a man can be a king after the order of men we saw in the New Testament, like the apostles. Isaiah prophesied and called them trees of righteousness, meaning they have the judgments of God. Meaning they can judge like God judges. And that is the greatest fear of the enemy. For men to be raised with God's nature. For men to be able to live by the commandment of a faith that was revealed in the New Testament.
You're talking about like sons of God.
Yes.
Knowing their identity.
Exactly. For men to be able to live with the faith of God, which is the faith of the Son, which is meant to be lived in the days of our flesh. Mm-hmm. Paul said, the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son. Yet not I, but Christ. So that light is actually the light of Christ. So in other words, you and I are meant to journey to a place where we can embody that light. We can hold that light. We can keep the mystery of faith. We can hold it. It's tangible. And by living by that light, we journey to a place where we can overcome the world, because the world cannot understand that light.
Yeah, in my heart, though, I'm thinking light is the Holy Spirit.
Okay.
Am I misunderstanding something? Okay. I mean, I don't know if the audience is thinking like this. I want to make sure I understand you.
Okay, let me answer that question. In the book of Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13, it describes the Holy Spirit as the down payment until the redemption of the purchased possession. The purchased possession is the flock, according to Acts chapter 20, which he has purchased by his blood. So if the Holy Spirit has been given as a down payment, then the full payment must be the Son and the Father. And that's why James chapter 1 verse 17 now says, James chapter 1 verse 17, he says, all good and perfect gifts comes from the Father of lights. So what the, so what the Father has to give you and I, the church, is a good gift and a perfect gift. And if that good gift and perfect gift is coming from the Father of lights, that means those gifts are lights.
Yeah.
Those gifts are meant to make us receive that light he's giving. Good light. Perfect light. Or in other words, the light of faith and the light of love. Those are what I call the dollar and pounds of our walk in the Spirit. Mm. Those are the currency by which the soul is meant to live by faith.
Well, I imagine that if the Bride of Christ comes to your conference, they can understand this more, right? You'll probably teach it more in your conference.
Perfect.
Tell us your conference that's coming up here.
Yes, coming up from the 31st of May 2017 to the 3rd of June at Windham, which is at the Houston West Energy Corridor. And of course, we'll have the pleasure and the honor of having the likes of Pastor Carolyn Sissom.
Yay! Ministry. Yes.
We're also going to have God's servant, Reverend Carolyn Oyibuke, and his wife, Reverend Helen Oyibuke, all the way from Nigeria, ministering at the conference. So it promises to be an avenue where God will kiss the earth with righteousness. You know, David prophesied. He said, let righteousness look down from the throne and let truth spring forth from the earth. We are that earth. We are the earthen vessels. But we just need to receive that light. We need to be illuminated with that light. Like John the Baptist was, while he tarried in the wilderness. The wilderness for us in the New Testament is a type of Christ, where we are prepared for Canaan land, which is also like a type of the Father.
Yes.
So we're going to be hearing sound counsels that borders on how God wants to cause us to partake of the inheritance of the saints in light. Can you see that? The inheritance of the saints. So we're meant to inherit something, meaning something is meant to become tangible. We're meant to gain mastery over God's light.
Okay, now let's go back in time about your life.
Okay,
you was born in Nigeria?
Yes, please.
Okay, and was you born in a big family, small family, and was you born Christian?
No, I was born in a Christian family, but of course that does not make me a Christian.
Right.
At the point in time came, I had to give my life to the Lord and begin a relationship with Him. That's about 21 years ago.
Oh, okay. So you grew up in Nigeria?
Yes, please.
So you, the first 21 years of your life, you was not saved?
That was 21 years from now.
Oh, okay, yeah, yeah.
I'm just about 40, so that's about 13, some
yeah, he's
19 years.
He's 40.
Yeah,
I got you. Okay, well, tell us about your life. Like, how did you find God?
Okay, well, I knew God existed. I knew I needed to respond to God, but like many of us, I wanted to enjoy the world. I wanted to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. I wanted to have my own taste of it.
Yeah.
But at a point in time, I realized God's call upon, I need to be sincere with the Lord. So I went before the Lord. I told Him, I said, God, I'm a liability in your hands. Can you fashion me to be an asset?
Fashion you to be what?
To be an asset.
An asset?
Yes, I know it's a liability.
Yeah, oh, God.
Yeah, because of
that's
darkness.
Good. Yeah. Yes.
So, and there I was, I stood, I just reported myself to God. I told Him to take control of my life.
Yeah.
And that was the beginning. That was in November 15, 1995. You know, and I went all the way out to make myself available. I began to witness to people concerning the little. I had a trade secret. I call it a trade secret. Yeah. Whatever light that comes my way, I like people to know about it. So I like sharing anything that God blesses me with. And somewhere I believe over time that committed God to keep, you know, investing light in me, investing the knowledge of the truth, you know. So, but a destiny defining moment came for me in the year 2000 when I met God's servant, who by God's grace I've been with in the last 17 years, by name Reverend Makadi Oguke. You know, God ordained it, and I came across him, and what he was saying sounded strange. And the reason was because it was a meal that was not just the milk of the word, but as it were, an allocation which we can call the meat of the word. Paul said, when I came to you, I could not come to you as unto spiritual, but as unto babes in Christ. I need to feed you with milk over and over.
Yes.
In meaning, you could not teach them the meat, which was what was later written in the epistles, which is what will perfect us in the faith of the Son. So when I came across him, I could not really counsel some of the things he said, but in wisdom I just sat and I learned, and it took me some 10 years, I sat for over 10 years, it's about 17 years, but gradually in the first 1-2 years I began to grasp the teachings. I could put like a jigsaw puzzle, I could connect the thoughts, I could see.
What was his teaching?
His teaching basically was the portal he normally used was Romans chapter 1 verse 16. I am not ashamed.
Romans chapter 1
verse 16.
Verse 16.
He says, I am not ashamed of the gospel, For it is the power of God to everyone that believes. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. So when I have from faith to faith, it's talking to believers who are already saved, and it's talking about a faith that Jesus uttered, a faith that was not revealed in the Old Testament, a faith that was embodied for the first time in the work of our Lord Jesus. And that faith has a beginning and has an end.
He's the author and the finisher.
Yes. Okay. First Peter chapter 1, verse 19 says, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your soul. It's not talking about the faith that was available in the Old Testament. So I began to connect the puzzles. But like I said, the portal was Romans chapter 1, verse 16, because it takes the revelation of God's righteousness to which is God's judgment. How does God think? It took the first person to embody, to receive those judgments was our Lord Jesus. So whenever that righteousness is being revealed, you know, the substances for that faith walk have been communicated. So he kept teaching on from Romans chapter 1, he would compare scripture with scripture and would bring forth an understanding. But the time came, it now became tangible. And I saw that, you know, like Paul said, hold the mystery of faith. Meaning, once upon a time, the faith that was revealed in the New Testament is mysterious. Meaning our human comprehension can't comprehend it. But in the place of hearing, because faith, either the faith of the milk of the word or the faith in the epistles comes by hearing. So I kept hearing until the judgments surrounding that faith, which are the judgments of the righteousness of God, became more and more tangible to me, you know, and it now became a conversation.
Well, I'm going to take you back in time a little bit again.
Okay.
Most of the audience that you're talking to right now are Americans.
Okay.
So I want you to teach us a little bit about your culture. Like, you was raised in Nigeria. What is it, a mostly Muslim, Hindu?
Mostly Christians.
Mostly Christian?
Yes.
Okay, so it's a mostly Christian nation.
Yes.
Okay, so then you grew up and you began to understand the Lord, have a revelation of the Lord.
Yes,
now, when did you start traveling the world?
Well, that was in, a word came to God's servant, Reverend Kennedy, okay, that was in year 2000, that he should prepare to have an outreach because of the apostolic call upon his life.
Uh-huh.
He stands in the office of a prophet and also has been privileged to have experienced, you know, an apostolic grace that enables him to establish the saints and ministries, you know, strengthen ministries in New Testament truth. So the word came concerning the work in London, which by God's grace has gathered momentum way back in 2000. But of course, you know, you have to wait on prophecy. When that word came, we had to wait. And not until about year 2000 did we have our first outreach, which was also like a believers' convention.
Yes.
In London. So it was on the second occasion, that was in the year 2011, when we're having the conference at London. We're just praying, waiting and praying for the evening session, when that word came, turn to America. So if I answer your question, I'll say, way back 2010, when we had our first outreach.
So you was in London in 2011?
Yes, please.
So was I.
Wow.
Was you there around Christmas?
No, I was there. That was in April.
Oh, April. Okay.
Even though we're now having April, two editions, April and August or September.
Gotcha. Okay. Well, let's move it forward now. You're in America. You're doing these conferences. You're trying to bring an awareness to Americans of your revelation of the light and your understanding of this revelation. Okay, and you coming from Nigeria, you have the Christian background there, and I mean, I don't know, like, the way that Nigeria sees America,
okay,
like how their media portrays us or whatever, okay, versus how it is when you come over here and you actually see it yourself. And then now, since we've had this huge transition in our nation just this past year, we would love to hear your opinion. Like, what do you think about America right now?
America is a nation that is very strategic in God's plan.
Say that again.
America is a nation that is very strategic in the plan of God.
Strategic in the plan of God. Yeah, yes.
When,
okay.
When the church in America, which is the light in America, when that church gets it right, many nations will get it right.
Yeah. Come on. That's right. Amen. Yes, we're so, like the light of the world.
America had the honor of experiencing what I call an allocation in God's word, an allocation of light. You know, your constitution, for example, is fashioned around one of the prophecies of Isaiah: "The Lord thy God is thy lawgiver; the Lord thy God is thy, you know, is thy judge." You know, all those confirm to me that, you know, America has a foundation of faith. Amen. But of course, you see in Isaiah chapter 28, I think verse 9 and 10. Isaiah was speaking, he says, "Who shall he teach knowledge? And who shall he cause to understand doctrine? Is it he that is weaned from the breast and drawn from the milk?" He that is drawn from the milk and weaned from breast. So the church in America corporately has partaken of an allocation of God's word, which is
God's what?
Which is God's word. God's word.
Word, okay. Yeah,
which is the milk of the word.
Okay,
the first meal a believer can experience, just like a newborn babe, is the milk of the word,
yeah.
Or the elementary principles of the doctrine of Christ. It's not the actual principle of Christ. Christ did not live by that principle. We are living by it because we have a background, a carnal background. So in the days of our carnality, meaning in the days when we live by our natural judgment, in the day when we live by a mind that is not yet the mind of Christ, we can relate to the milk of the word. What is the milk of the word? If we check Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1, it says, "Leaving therefore the elementary principles of the doctrines of Christ, let us go on to perfection." Meaning those elementary principles, which are the milk of the word, cannot perfect. That's why at a point in time, you need to be weaned from that meal. So what are those elementary principles of the doctrines of Christ? One, of faith towards God. That's what gave birth to what we have as the prosperity move. Of faith towards God. Repentance from dead works. Doctrines of baptism. Many of the Baptist church was raised by that light, you know, and of eternal judgment. Verse 3 says, "This we will do if God permits." Meaning at a season in the calendar of the church, that light or that meal becomes secondary. Something else should become primary. Meaning what should perfect should become primary. And what is that? That was what he said in the previous verse, Hebrews chapter 5, from verse 13. He says, "At the time you ought to be teachers, you need someone that will teach you again what are the elementary principles of the doctrines of Christ."
So you're saying that, I just want to make sure I understand you right.
Okay.
You're saying that America, we do have a foundation of Christ.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
But you're saying that we've strayed from that, which we all agree as ministers. We've strayed from our foundations.
Yes, please.
So you're saying that we should go back to the foundational principles of
Christ? Not primarily. I'm saying after the church in America received the foundation of faith, which is the milk of the word, which gave birth to, you know, the healing move, the prosperity move, the word of faith move,
yeah.
There was something that there was another allocation, there was another meal that the church was meant to subscribe to, was meant to embrace.
We call those, in our language, we call those streams.
Streams, okay, exactly.
He's saying the word, we had the word of faith stream.
Yes, please.
We had the healing stream, which we can all, if you studied revivals, yes, that's it. And then the other one. But you're saying there's one that we've not grasped yet.
Yes, please.
Okay, come on, fill us in.
Okay, there's what the milk of the word does, which is the foundation of faith, is that it helps the outward man. That's when you have healing of the outward body.
Yes.
But you see, man is a spirit, lives in a body, and has a soul. The soul is also a man. The soul is the inner man. So the inner man also needs to be strengthened, needs to be raised, needs to be healed.
Yes, and which we call our mind, will, and emotion.
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah, so basically, the soul is the heart and the mind.
Yes.
The mind is the window to the soul. The heart is the seat of the soul. That's where the sower was met, you know, sowed the good word, or the, you know, where the word.
Brad, you got to be deep to take this in. Let me tell you.
So in a nutshell, there is a revelation of Christ, which is what we have in the epistles. Yes. All the epistles, they are meeting. Paul called them, it says in 2 Peter chapter 3, it says, our brother Paul, whom God gave wisdom, seeing that he is communicating things that are hard to be understood. They are hard to be understood because they are meat. You need to break them down. You need to be taught. But it's in those teachings that the light in the meat, which are the judgments of the meat, will open up. And that's when our soul will be strengthened. In fact, that is what will save our soul. So there's a faith that solves our problems, but there's a faith that will heal our soul. It says, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your soul. So there's a faith that we have known, it has solved problems, it has delivered us. But with all those deliverances, we cannot yet handle some higher warfare. We cannot yet overcome the adversary. We need a faith that John says, this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith.
So it's basically a faith stream.
Yes, please.
Wow, come on. God, we're going to need the faith. I'll see what you're saying in America, okay? Because the darkness is all around us. Yes, I mean, there's no doubt. We are the light as his children, lights out here in the darkness. But there's a greater place for us to step into is what you're saying.
Yes, please.
Very good. Okay, very good. I pray you understood that, Brad. Because he is trying to bring the revelation about the light, which is why he's doing his conference coming up the end of this month right here in Houston if you want to come. Okay, now, what would you say happened? What would you say, well, I guess you already said it about the light. I was about to ask you, what is God saying to America? But basically that we're going into this new move, right?
Yes. America also is being given an opportunity by God, which is, when you say America, I'm talking about the churches, but the churches are, that's whom the Lord has a relationship with. So when we are seeing it, the doors of some churches are opening to this aspect of the gospel, which is actually the gospel of Christ. This is what was not available in the Old Testament. The faith by which we experience provision from God concerning our natural lives, healing was available way back in the Old Testament. It was called faith towards God. But there's a faith that has victory over everything the world represents. What makes generations of Christians carnal is the world. So we need a faith that will overcome that world. So gradually we are seeing the churches respond. We are seeing the churches open their doors. You know, we are seeing men giving a right hand of fellowship, like we saw in Galatians chapter 2, when Peter, James, and John, but we use that word, said that seemed to be pillars. He said, when they perceived the grace upon me, that was Paul. Paul had already caught a revelation of Christ's faith. The apostles had done many exploits with a faith that was not actually the faith of the Son. From the book of Acts chapter 3, till when they met him, but when they gave him a right hand of fellowship, Paul now communicated what he revealed by revelation.
Yeah.
Which is meant to establish us on the present truth, because the present truth is Christ.
Well, all righty. Okay, let's see. Well, we're going to pray for you and for your ministry. We ask whenever we have people on the broadcast to come together in unity and to pray. And we ask that the bride across the world pray for you to bless you, and then we'll ask that you pray for us. Lord, the bride, we come together in agreement for our brother, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you bless him in the United States of America, Lord. Bless him in everything he does, Lord. Give him the tools and strategies he's going to need to accomplish the mission that you have called him to, Lord. Bless his family with health, Lord. Bless their finances, Lord. Bless everything he puts his hands to, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. If you would please pray for America.
Okay, Father, I want to thank you for your saints that are out there, privileged to hear the witness that you've just tried to bear concerning your light. We want to thank you for how far we have tarried around a mountain for long. But we want to thank you for the clarion call to come up hither. And Lord, we are saying the church will receive strength upon upon her knees, the church will come into the knowledge of his will, which was the prayers that the apostles prayed for every church while you were about to win them from that which they were previously familiar with. It was the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. And so we agree with this agenda of yours. We say there will be enlightenment. We say they will be humble enough to open their hearts like the earlier, like the apostles of the Lamb did when they met with Paul. They gave him a right hand of fellowship. We thank you for the, your present emphasis. The present emphasis of the Spirit of the church will find favor in the hearts of men, because the set time is come, even the time to favor Zion. Thank you for everyone out there that is meant to become a stone of Zion. But we thank you for how you will strengthen their knees to journey up Zion. You will strengthen them with that knowledge that Daniel prophesied about, that when he said, when he talked about how they that know their God shall be strong. We thank you for that strength in the knowledge of your Son, in the knowledge of his life, in the knowledge of his power, in the knowledge of his faith. We thank you for how in humility it will be received by everyone, so that we can take that upward mobile journey of Zion and become stones of Zion. Your word will be proceeding out of Zion, because that word is meant to bring us to Zion, even to the Lamb and to the Father. Thank you, Father, for this will be our portion as a people, even in this day, in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you for the new identity that the church in America will bear, because they will embrace this light, because there is a light that shines in darkness, and darkness comprehends it not. Father, we give you thanks. I will give you the glory for this. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Don't shut it off yet. I am having a hard time with this light. I don't know if I'm not comprehending it or what. Is, are you saying that it's the Holy Spirit? I want to make sure that people understand what you're saying. Okay. Are you saying it's the Holy Spirit? I don't, for some reason, my mind is not grasping the light.
Okay. Let me try and paraphrase it again.
Please, because I'm thinking, you know, Jesus, Holy Spirit, God.
Okay.
You know, okay. I just want to make sure
okay.
we're understanding.
Let me summarize it. When a believer is born, he's like a child. He's
yes.
like a babe. He has to take his mother's breast milk. That's the first meal he takes for the first 1 year. Perhaps 1.5 years, exclusive, is on breast milk. But the time comes, you have to wean that child from breast milk and
give I'll explain
the interpretation, the application. And then you have to give him semi-solid cereals. But the time comes, he can, maybe when he's about 3, 4, 5, he can now take meat. He can take chicken. So in like manner, there are different meals in the scriptures. You have a faith that a newborn believer can relate with. What brought him to the church were his needs. He needed healing.
Yeah.
He needed a car. He needed a house. He needed a deliverance. He's been afflicted, you know, bodily or whatever. So there is a faith that proves that caters for our carnal needs. But all those needs are not our spiritual needs. All those needs will not give us the nature of God. So we come to church seeking God for needs, not seeking God for God.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus was not seeking God for those needs. Jesus was seeking God for God, and that's how he inherited God.
Yes, I get that.
Okay, so like Isaiah said, who shall he teach knowledge? When we get born again, we started by believing. Paul said it. Paul said, I know in whom I have believed. So after believing, at a point in time came, he changed cause, or he changed what he was feeding on from milk to meat, because the judgments around the meat of the world is different from the judgments or the thought process around the meat of the world. Are you with me? So a point in time, for example, from 1995 to year 2000, before I met God's servant, I was on milk of the world. But when I met him, I saw a different thought process. I saw a different approach to faith. You hear in the epistles, Paul will talk about faith that is in me, talking about Christ. It says in Acts chapter 28, verse 16, opening their eyes, meaning a believer cannot relate to that eye without faith until the eyes of his heart is enlightened. Opening their eyes, turning them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to the power of God, that they might receive remission of sins and inheritance of faith that is in me, in Christ. So there's a faith that is in Christ. When a believer comes to church or gets born again, he is not seeking for that faith. That faith is what will make him Christ-like. That faith is what will make him overcome the world. But he still loves the world. He's still seeking after the world. So there's a faith that he can relate to.
I call that like a battle of the flesh and the spirit.
Right? Yes, yes, yes. You can say so. So when you look at all the epistles, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15, when I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and of your love in the Lord toward all the saints, I cease not to make mention of you in prayers, praying that God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of great glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation. Those are the eyes.
Yes.
The eyes to relate to the judgment of Christ's faith. May give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. The eyes of your understanding, that the eyes of your understanding might be enlightened. So, even though they have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and they could love all the brethren, all the saints, but that faith was a faith for the outer courts. So, Paul had to pray that by the spirit of wisdom and revelation, they will be given eyes. Their soul, which was blinded through darkness, will be given eyes to be able to process the judgment or reasoning, to be able to reason concerning the knowledge of Christ, or the knowledge of him, which is Christ. So in other words, Paul was praying that they will be able to relate, they will be able to chew the meat of the word, they will be able to receive the revelations that are around the righteousness of God.
Which in my understanding, that's hunger. Well, the way I describe, I'm hungry for more of him.
Yeah, you have to be hungry for righteousness. When the Bible says, blessed are they, that's what Jesus was saying.
Yeah.
Blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. What will they be filled with? They'll be filled with life. What Jesus said in John chapter 10, verse 10, I am come that men may have life. So before Jesus came, there was a kind of life that was not the life Jesus was offering. The life Jesus was offering is the life of his faith. So by virtue of being blessed, we're praying that the church in America, God, they will receive the blessing of righteousness, to hunger for that righteousness, which is the righteousness of God, which is revealed from faith to faith. The faith Jesus uttered and the faith he finished. The faith that he says in Hebrews chapter 12, run with patience the faith that is the race that is set before you. That is the race, that is the journey of the holy place. And that's why you need the menorah, or the spirit of wisdom, revelation, counsel, might.
Yes,
knowledge.
The seven spirits of God.
So those spirits, they illuminate, they give us light in the holy place so that we can walk in Christ. Well, we can walk in his faith and we can be established. So,
exactly.
So any other faith before the faith Christ revealed cannot establish the soul. He said it is good for the heart to be established with, not with meat, but with grace. That grace was what Jesus brought. So the churches, by God's grace, will be established as they begin to hear the faith of the Son.
And I'm sure there's a lot to it that I'm just not understanding, so please forgive me.
No, it's okay.
But go to the conference and you'll learn more about it. Amen. Okay, well, God bless you, Brian, and we'll see you soon.